This is the Writers Podcast. A Writers After Dark radio production, bringing you the best in writing advice, news, trends, and interviews. Hosted by award-winning authors SK Anthony and Raymond Esposito.
Hey everyone, thanks for joining us at the Writers Podcast. I'm SK Anthony and I'm here with Raymond Esposito. And tonight we'll be discussing the ways to know if you're ready to publish.
Hello, Catherine. How you doing?
I'm good, thank you. And I'm enjoying my drink.
Excellent. You know, when you think about publishing, throughout the 20th century, book publishing was a gated industry. Agencies and ultimately publishers, they decided if a book had the merit and saleability to hit the press, so to speak. If the content and the writing were good enough, then the publisher ensured the book appeared to the public in its best form. Good cover, yep. Edited, all of those things. Mm-hmm. Published books still might not meet with the reader's love, but technically they met certain standards of readability, if not enjoyability.
Yeah, and let's face it. Most authors want to ensure their published works are well received. They'd want to know, you know, questions like, is my book good enough? Have I made any errors? Should I put it out there? These are the questions that haunt self-published authors. And if they don't, they really should.
Yes.
You and I, Raymond, we agree, right?
Mm-hmm.
A healthy dose of uncertainty and insecurity goes a long way to driving writers to improve their craft.
Yeah, I mean, provided you're not frozen, paralyzed, in analysis paralysis and never published, it's good to have a little bit of insecurity.
Yeah, but look, the truth is, no one can tell you if readers are going to enjoy your book.
Oh.
If you look at any book's reviews, you'll see a huge range of mixed thoughts and feelings on, you know, on the same story. The second truth is, no one can tell you not to publish. I think that's probably the most dangerous one. You know, there lies the third truth, right? The somewhat ugly and, well, hurtful truth. Just because you can do something doesn't mean that you should.
Absolutely. And I think of self-publishing like reaching the legal drinking age. Just because you can legally drink, it doesn't mean all the other drinking rules are off the table.
Mm-hmm.
A fact that most people learn before they actually reach the legal drinking age. With publishing, there aren't any, and what we're going to talk about isn't a set bunch of rules because there really aren't any. Instead, we're going to provide just a little bit of advice so you don't show up on your new job Monday morning stupid drunk.
Yes, I may have done that on a Saturday morning on occasion when I was very young. But hey, anyway,
mm-hmm.
It ultimately does fall on you, the author, to decide if your book is ready for prime time. But here are some things to help guide you that decision.
And some of these are just questions. And the first question is to ask yourself, are you an avid reader? I am so surprised when I discover someone who writes a fiction novel and then self-professes that they've never been a fan of reading. What I'm not surprised with, however, is when I find that person's story is poorly written, filled with cliched characters, and, you know, basically overused prose.
Right. Because in never knowing what has come before, this non-reader can't possibly have a grasp of the art form. You know, reader's expectation precedes story arcs. If you can count the number of books you've read on one hand, you're going to have to be a natural storyteller to pull that first book off, right?
Yeah.
And I'm not going to lie, I might be a little jealous of that natural storyteller ability.
Yeah, no, I mean, that's an excellent point. And on this next point, many authors are probably going to disagree with me and some will be downright angry at the suggestion. But I stand by my thought on this. A part of your reading material, if you're going to be a writer, should absolutely be the classics. You don't have to go out and write your own classic. But understanding those nuances of how the greats weave their tales, the way they embedded important human themes in their narratives, and their ability to master both the complex and simple sentences, knowing that stuff is just going to make you a better writer, in my opinion.
I don't disagree with you. I guess reading boring stuff can teach you things if you stay awake.
Yeah, the best learning comes from boring stuff.
No, I'm kidding. But, you know, on the other hand, you can also learn a lot from present-day authors. You know, we all know the saying, the crew never rises above the captain. It's a real consideration for any author. To be the best writer you can requires a comparison to the best writers who have come before as much as with your peers. And I think that's going to bring us to, you know, the second trend way. You're reading these other authors, and what's the one thing that you're going to look for? Their genre.
I think a part of the reading experience, too, is to answer this next important question, and that is, do you know your genre? Like a story arc, genres have certain rules and expectations. If you want to write romance, you should understand how romance stories play out. And the same applies to every other genre. Unique is great. Original is also a good idea. But if you break off completely from the genre's expectations, your story just might not be well received.
Yeah, and these rules aren't necessarily of grammar or mechanics. Nope. They are more subtle than that. And an easy way to think about a suggestion is to consider it in terms of environment. Like the mountains, they look much different than the beach. You would dress differently when visiting each, right? There's a different feel, a different mindset, and different in what you expect to encounter. Genres all fit into the writing world, but each has a unique feel that you should understand as a writer.
Yeah, your reader is just going to expect certain things to play out, certain themes, a certain way things happen. If you don't understand that, and I think a great example of why it's important, we can observe that in J.K. Rowling's work. You know, here is the master of children's literature, and yet she struggled to be likable in her attempts at adult fiction. Now, maybe that's because, you know, readers just want more Harry Potter, but also it's possible that maybe adult fiction was a world of writing that she didn't really understand.
Yeah, it's possible she branched out, like, really far away from not just any adult. She went into, like, politics of sorts.
Yeah.
So, but, you know, I mean, I don't know. I'm a big fan of the children section of it, but yeah, you're right. I cannot connect to the adult section of it.
And I think another area to concern yourself with, if you're asking the question, am I ready to do this, is focus and attention, because every writing attempt will improve the writing. You know, the brain, it's an incredible muscle, and like all muscles, it grows stronger through exercise. Now, I'm not suggesting you need to write novels to be ready to publish a novel, but if your first draft is the thing you plan to release, I would warn that it's probably a mistake. But the good news is writing is writing, and many novelists have never penned a short story to get ready for a novel, but they were journalists. Many nonfiction authors, they have years of experience in science or business writing.
Yeah, and even blogging counts toward that writing practice.
It does. It gets that focus and that attention and that really practice. You know, before my first novel, I had written volumes of business papers and dozens of short stories and enough term papers that I felt comfortable with my ability to write fiction. Looking back, I think I'd still like the opportunity to revise my first novel simply because my skills have continued to improve. But if you're limited in writing experience, then you might want to consider a couple of further revisions before you actually publish that book.
Oh, I go back and forth. Do I want to go back and fix my first book? Yes.
Yeah.
But I really want to look at it again? I don't know. Mm-hmm. I don't think I'm that brave. Which brings me, you know, to our next point. Even if you've been writing for years, even if you believe you've written the best story you can muster, it's best to take one more shot at revisions before you publish.
Well, I just have to say, you are absolutely, if there's an island called revisions, you are its queen. You love the revisions. Me, not as many as you.
Yeah, I guess that's my thing. Mm-hmm. Anyway, some authors, you know, they suggest things like hiding the manuscript in the drawer for 6 months and then returning with fresh set of eyes.
Yeah, I'm just not that patient. I mean, I just spent too many years putting aside my short stories into drawers, virtual or otherwise, to want to do the same with my novel. Maybe it would help. But that aside, I don't publish first versions. I don't publish second versions. And mostly I don't even publish third. You got to do the work. I don't think you have to put it away, but you better be working on revisions before you just hit publish.
Right. I mean, look, for each author, the required revisions will differ. Mm-hmm. Dean Quince doesn't leave a page until it's perfect. Stephen King does the see you in 6 months routine. I revise about 100 times. I get a couple beta reads. I revise another 50 times. I edit, I revise, edit, get more betas, revise, and then I send to the editor. Then, believe it or not, I usually make more tweaks while approving the edits. I don't know what to tell you. I have issues.
Well, we started publishing at the same time, and just by book count alone, I obviously published twice as fast as you. That doesn't make my books better. We've both won awards. It just is. I'm doing less revisions because it's patience for me. I couldn't spend as much time on my book. Probably be better for it, but I couldn't spend as much time on my books as you do. Which
I think you know, my thing, I think, is has a lot to do with insecurity, right? Like, English is my second language, and I always think, oh, I don't have it right. Or I always, as I'm reading, I think, oh, no, I can make this better. But anyway, the important takeaway is that a good measurement for publication, for a good measurement of publication, and it has to go through at least a few revisions.
Yeah, and it doesn't matter if it's the whole book being revised or just sections. And I think a great place to start or somewhere in your revision process is the use of a beta reader to help you determine if that work is ready.
Oh, yeah.
You know, traditionally a beta reader is someone who reads your story and makes suggestions regarding things like cohesiveness of that arc, the consistency, the comprehension of the story, what you're trying to say, how things work together. They may provide specific suggestions on stuff like chapters and sections, or they may deliver an overview of their thoughts on the entirety of the storyline.
Yeah, you know, talking about that, some authors rely on one beta reader, while others use multiple beta readers. I believe in multiples, which is probably why I had twins. But anyway.
Two is better than one.
Regardless, your beta is your first real and objective reviewer of your story. I think if you're going with just one beta reader, it's critical he or she is someone with experience and someone who can be objective.
Not my mom?
Your husband. No, not your mommy.
What about my
not
wife?
Not your significant other. Not your BFF. Well, I don't know. If you want to call me your BFF, maybe I can't. But
yeah.
Otherwise, they would not be your best choice. But look, you could go with one. But like I said, they have to really know what they're doing. But I believe in more than one. And a variety is best. Yes, having someone who reads or writes in your genre is fantastic. But I think there is something to be said for having someone who doesn't read that genre.
I actually think someone who doesn't read in your genre is an important, or doesn't write or read in your genre. I mean, mm-hmm. You beta my work, and you're not mm-hmm. a dark fiction writer. It definitely helps. I think that the advice you get helps you really understand, are you reaching the reader? Because this is a person who doesn't have the expectations.
Yeah. If your story is making sense to an outsider, so to speak, you don't have to do everything they say, but you have to make it make sense to them, right? And if it makes sense to someone who doesn't read your genre, that's like hitting gold.
Right. So that's what I was mumbling through. So we could probably just cut my section and go exactly with what you said.
No. But you know, if more than one of them agree on something, you definitely should listen to them, even if you're not completely agreeable to every single thing they're mentioning to you.
You know, and there is, of course, a cost in using such services, but I think it's well worth the price because, you know, beta readers, a good beta reader will find the most glaring issues, and the good one, like mine, tend to know the things that are going to confuse or disappoint or aggravate your audience. Beta readers differ in their level of service they offer and the depth that they dive into the critique. So, I mean, yep. It's not a foolproof system. I prefer a beta reader who acts more as a developmental editor, as you do,
yeah.
Although the cost of such a service is a bit higher.
Hey.
Not from you to me, but the input has definitely saved sections of my story several times. So I think this is the kind of place where, yeah, you're going to spend a little bit of money, but it's definitely worth it.
Yeah, I've invested in it myself. And listen, if you can't afford it, go and find readers on Goodreads and ask for feedback. Any feedback is better than none. And believe me, readers know their likes and dislikes, and they're not afraid to say so in reviews. So even if you can't afford a professional beta reader or content editor, you can still get help from people who'll read your work for free.
You know, I did that with The Devil's Hour.
Yeah.
And this was before I had met you. And I had a couple of people on Goodreads who I just had them read the first chapter. I didn't bother them with the whole book. I just wanted to get a sense. And this one guy, he says, listen, this is, you know, there's very little I can say here. And then he just made a couple of points. But the couple of points he made were just, they were perfect. They were spot on. I just had missed it. And so even though he didn't think he was doing me any favors or doing anything for the chapter, really made a difference. So I like the Goodreads thing, if you can find someone to do it for you. But I suggest having a professional do it.
Look, you're a writer. You should probably also go out there and get to know other writers. Get into the community. Yeah. Everybody is looking for someone who can help them. You help them, they'll help you. And there's nothing wrong with scratching each other's back when it comes to this. You're in this together. Every story is different. There's so many readers out there. There's no competition.
Right.
Writers help each other out. Even if you feel uncomfortable going to Goodreads and finding a reader, go ahead and make friends with other authors. They're looking for the same thing as you are.
Yeah, listen, I think there's a variety of choices with beta reading. And the one thing I would just warn about is if someone beta reads your book and the comment is, well, this is just great, and that's their answer, I would probably continue to look for somebody else. Because let's face it, I don't care how good you are. Nothing is great the first time out. And although beta readers, you've got some flexibility on this next point, the sixth way to really know if you're ready to publish is not a place where you should just go with, you know, the friends and family plan, and that's editing. If you're contemplating publishing story using only your word processor as an editor, I'd strongly warn against it, even if you have a degree in grammar from Harvard. Today, most readers, they don't care about the occasional typo or the incorrect comma placement or the semicolon, and most wouldn't know the difference between some of these uses. But unfortunately, the people most likely to leave a review, they do know the rules of grammar. And if you make more than a few mistakes, they're going to let the world know that you didn't take the time to do it right.
Goodness, yes. And, you know, that kind of reputation is going to follow you for many years. As authors, we really cannot afford a book full of errors. We're on the same page with this. Quality and pride is in your work truly, truly, truly matters.
Yeah, and editing is definitely the most challenging part of the process, especially for a creative writer. But perhaps in the end, it's the most important. You don't want problems with the mechanics of your work to get in the way of the story. It's a terrible thing to say, but if you can't afford a professional edit, then you probably aren't ready to publish.
Yeah, you can't see it, but it does really help your story shine through.
And one place where they'll point out these issues with professional editing and other things is, and it's a great way to kind of go to the next step, the book is done, you think it's ready, is to get a professional review. And I'm talking about professional reviews like Publishers Weekly, Clarion, Kirkus. I'm not doing an ad for them. But these are paid reviews in the sense that you do have to pay money to get them. The advantage in using them is you will definitely get professional feedback on how good your story is in meeting up with the expectations of the genre. And also at that point that you get a professional review, the great thing about self-publishing is it's never too late to pull it back. So you write your book, you hit publish, you get one of these professional reviews. And if they're really slaying the thing, you've got the opportunity to pull it back and try again.
Yeah, a lot of authors do end up doing that. You know, you learn the hard way. But, you know, the benefit is if you pass a test from one of these professional, you know, review services, you are off to a good start. And if they kill your book, you could save yourself a lot of hardship by taking the opportunity to make some changes.
In the end, however, even these professional review services are just another opinion. But if you're looking for a reality check on your story's quality, it's still an excellent way to go.
It is. And this also, you know, brings us to ARCs and contests. ARCs are advanced reader's copies. The more input you receive on your novel, the better you'll feel about putting it on the market. And ARCs, they are an excellent way to solicit feedback on your book's mass reception. There are many people who love to read free books and provide someone honest feedback. You can sign up for, you know, for book tours for a small cost, and you'll get honest reviews on your book. This is true for any author, and even if it's your very first book, and even if no one has ever heard of you. How do I know this? Well, you know, I did this. I set up a tour for 8 weeks before publication of my first book, Kinetic, and the week that I released it, I got a few reviews every day of the week. The word of mouth was pretty good for a newcomer. And let me tell you, my release week, it was pretty successful. I really can't complain.
I wish I had thought about that, but I didn't know anything about publishing when I did the first book. And most ARCs, most of the advanced readers, they'll tread somewhat lightly on issues that they find problematic. So I think your job is to read between the lines and improve where you can when helpful advice is offered. To just ignore reviews and ignore the advice you're getting from your book and say, well, they don't understand, they didn't get it. If the reader doesn't get it, nobody gets it. Again, this feedback is just an opinion. And, you know, there's a difference between a reader who didn't like a story or a character and a reader who suggests you might want to proofread. When, you know, if they say you should proofread some of your sentences, that's a nice way of saying you're not, this wasn't edited. And the first is opinion, and the second is obviously pointing out the mechanical issues in your book.
Yeah, you know, so maybe the best way to know how good your story is to enter in a book contest. There are hundreds out there. Most cost money to enter, and your story will be up against thousands of other entries. The chances of winning or placing are slim, and at doing such isn't an indicator that your story sucks. It's simply means that other stories were a bit better.
Yeah, it doesn't. So
look, I write in urban fantasy genre, and when I entered my one and only contest, let me tell you, I was sweating bullets, which I imagine we all do anyway. But it is a very popular genre, and the fact that I got up to top four with the honorary award was shocking. But I'm not gonna lie, I was also a little crushed that it made top three.
I do think the hardest part of that award for you was the fact that the ceremony for receiving it occurred on the same day we left for the cruise, yes. On our cruise. So, and we did pass it. We passed right by it. And I thought about you, you know, as we went by, SK was supposed to get our award tonight, but let's go drink pina coladas.
I love how you're saying it so nicely. I thought about you. You teased me. You were like, oh, too bad. You could have been receiving your award right now.
Listen, I don't know. You know, the award, the cruise, it was a tough check. You know, the question, though, is, yeah, we just spelled out how difficult it is, how challenging, and the fact that you probably won't place or win because you're with thousands of other people. You know, so you might say, well, why would I even bother doing this?
Yeah.
And I would say that, well, if you do win or place against hundreds or thousands or hundreds of thousands of other entries, you know, that's really good confirmation that your story is good, or at least good enough.
Is it? Like, I don't know. Like, I feel good, but I don't feel that good.
Because you suffer from imposter syndrome, which we'll talk about in another episode. You know, and it's not, you know, contests and it's not the end all. And it doesn't mean you'll be hitting the bestseller list. I can say that from experience. But it does make those harsh reviews that you might get a lot easier to take when you know, hey, I got an award, so shut up.
Yeah. You know, like we said from the start, no one can tell you whether or not you're ready to publish. It's a personal decision. There is no surefire way to know in advance the reception your book will receive, especially when you consider that the big five publisher picks losers all the time.
thousands of books in Barnes & Noble nobody's reading, so don't feel bad. Yeah. And these eight steps, though, they can give you a general, you know, I think they provide a general snapshot of your book's preparedness. And I'd suggest that if you don't use the first six, that you're probably taking a significant risk in publishing. There's far more books on the market than there are ever going to be readers for. And like most things in life, we don't get a second chance to make a first impression. So whatever you publish, do the best job you can.
Yeah. And, you know, with that in mind, the best advice we can offer is, if you don't think your book is quite ready, then wait and continue to work on it. Conversely, remember, even on the day you publish, you'll never really be certain how your work will be received. So sooner or later, you'll have to take that risk.
Indeed. So we'll leave you with this quote from Stephen Hawkins. The greatest enemy of knowledge isn't ignorance. It's the illusion of knowledge.
Thank you for listening to the Writer's Podcast. Be sure to subscribe so you never miss an episode. For more articles, news, and advice, visit our website, writersafterdark.net, or follow us on Facebook and Twitter. The Writers Podcast is a Writers After Dark radio production. Executive producers SK Anthony and Raymond Esposito. Copyright 2017.